Hello, my name is Mads Christophersen. You're listening to Just Baatein.
Hey guys, welcome back to Just Baatein. My name is Aswin and it's a Sunday episode. And you know what that means. We have a guest on, we listen to them, talk about them. It's an experience both of us hold on to. Now, let's list things out for a second before we go on. We have had international cricketers on. We have had sports broadcasters on. We have had an F2 driver. We have had an F1 esports driver. But this is a new one and this is a very special one. But before that, Praatibh, how are you, man? How's everything going? And who is the special guest of ours?
Hey guys, everything's going great and I have a little bit of a laggy internet. So I'm sorry if anything goes wrong in the middle of this episode. But anyways, as Aswin said, we have a very special guest with us today. He's represented Denmark at the highest level. He's a badminton player. We have with us Mads Christophersen. Hey man, how's it going?
Hello. Thank you guys for having me. It's a pleasure. Yes, I'm looking forward to this episode. I have listened to some of the other ones, but I'm not that much into cricket. But maybe I will be a bit more after I have listened to your podcast. So. Yeah,
it's great to have you here. It does mean a lot, the fact that you listen to us. It's nice. Before we get into your journey and experience and pick your brains on a little things, I have a icebreaker for you. We also know that your sister plays badminton and she's exceptional at it. She's been the junior champion, the European champion. But this is a sibling question. Both of us have siblings and we argue a lot. So I have a brother who plays cricket and we argue a lot in terms of who plays better and stuff. So do you have that amongst yourself? Do you criticize each other? Do you correct each other? How is the relationship there?
Yeah. Me and Line, just a fun story. Yesterday or was it it was Friday. We were in the gym and another player from the club was there. And me and Line, we were just like, to each other all the time, and yeah, so it's pretty normal that we're arguing, but it's in a good way and in a fun way. It's just we're making fun at each other and we have fun with that, but we also are sparring partners, so we can use each other for practice. Later today we will go down in the hall and do some technique, and we try to help each other to get better every day. So we also have that serious part in our relationship that we can push each other, and we can say something that we don't take personal as if others said it to us. So in that way I think we have a pretty professional relationship as well as we can do that. So I'm really happy that we both are into badminton like this.
That's really nice to hear. And moving on, just talking about sort of your childhood years and how you sort of got into badminton, could you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes, of course. Well, I have always played since I can remember with my parents me and Lina has a big brother as well, and he also played before us. And we have just other family members. I have some cousins who played, and their family played, and so all the family had played. So when I grew up, we played it a bit on vacations outside, and then I think when I was around 7, I started to badminton. I found out quite fast that I was actually quite good at badminton, because I could beat some of them who had trained for, I don't know, 2 years maybe or something. And I just won a lot at practice, and that was also fun. So I'm very competitive minded. So when I grew older, it become more and more badminton. So we actually have my father's side of the family, we have a farm, and on that farm we have a barn. We have a badminton court inside of one of those, so we played with our cousins when we were out and visit them, and I don't think I was that old, but we just have had fun playing. And then it got more serious when I grew older. So, yeah.
Okay. So it's nice you talked about how in as a child, I mean, you were doing pretty well. At what point did you sort of start facing maybe difficulties or adversities related to the sport or even otherwise?
I think that I was not one of the best when I was under 13 and under 15, but I was in the high end of Denmark, but I was not in like, I think I was maybe in top 20. I was under 15 and something like that. But I think that when I was under 15 in the second year, before I went up to under 17, I got selected for a team. We have this tournament in Denmark called Danish Junior Cup, where it's an international junior tournament. So we play like team matches against other countries, and Japan has been there, Spain and stuff like that. But that year I was selected. It was England and Netherlands and France and stuff like that. And we had a team from Copenhagen, and I was selected for that. Mm-hmm. And that made me feel like, okay, I'm getting closer to becoming one of the best in Denmark. And that gave me, and then I also won against the other players from the other countries. I played second men single, and I won against England and Netherlands and France, and they were some of the best from their countries. So maybe I was not the best in Denmark, but I was one of the best in Europe still at my age. So that gave me a huge drive. And then when I went up to under 17, I started in the second highest ranking. Rank in Denmark, so I had to get some points to move up to the best rank, and I actually won all the tournaments in a row that season, so that gave me also a really boost of in my confidence. But then I went up to the best rank, and the first match I just got my ass whooped, if I can say that. So I knew that there was still a way to go, but I also knew when I played my best, I could do something good against the best. And then the same year, I came into the semifinals at the Denmark Championship, and that was the first like medal I had got in the best rank in Denmark. So that was also huge for me. And I actually met Anders Antonsen in the semifinal, and I was playing pretty well against him. Mm-hmm. So I think that 2 years, they showed me that I wanted to do something more with the badminton, because I could see that I was getting better and better. But I would actually say that when I started to play senior, I had some trouble the first couple of years, because maybe I was fast and I was explosive and stuff, but I was not tactical good enough, and I lost a lot of matches because I couldn't stay in the game mentally. But I started to practice with Peter Gade when he was in France as a coach. So when he was home the second week, I trained with him, and of course that gave me a lot of good things in my badminton, but then I they started the academy, and I got really good practice that summer for like I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, 3 years ago, and I got so much better technical. But when I came into my first matches that year for that season, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what shot I should use, because I suddenly I could use a lot more shots than I was used to. Before it was just keep the net or lift or something like that. Now I could cross. I could play the flat lift or push, and I could play into in between games. I could play the close net. But I didn't know what time to use it. So So I had really trouble the first months after the academy started to like implementing the shots in my game. And I actually think that that's a good way to think of the saying, like, two steps forward, one step back.
Yeah.
Because my technical skills, like, they improved a lot, but it also made me feel like insecure of when to do it.
Right.
And then I had some trouble finding that, and then I suddenly it just worked out, and then I came into a good period of time, and then again I became better technical, and I was focusing on that a lot. And then again, I didn't know what to do when I was playing. So the last couple of years, when I had improved a lot technical, it mm-hmm. has also been like hard for me because of this that I could use so many more shots. But when to use it is also like, if you see the best players, you know, like, okay, that's not a shot they use mm-hmm. to play, but they can do it, but they choose not to play it so much because maybe they don't feel like that confident about it, or they just play more simple and right. without mistakes. But I think that right now where I am, I'm in a good period again. I have been focusing a lot on my front court, and I think it's starting to work. I felt that in Orléans Masters for some weeks ago, where I was in the finals. So I just enjoy playing badminton at the moment.
That's great to see, though, how you have built your confidence up over the years. And I think that's my next question, is in line with what you were saying, because sometimes having a lot of shots, even in cricket, having a lot of things to do can be a little difficult. So my question to you was, what do people think is easy to do in badminton when it's actually not? Because like you said, having a lot of shots is also a problem sometimes because you don't know when to play them. So what's that one thing that outsiders think it's easy in badminton, but it's actually quite difficult?
That's a good question. I think it's depending a little bit on the players. If you mm-hmm. if you see me and Line, it might look easy when we are attacking, but it's because we feel that's the most safe we can do if we are if we're under pressure. We feel like it's easier to play with a little bit more speed than shots that are a little bit slower. But I actually think that most of the shots in badminton, if you're good enough, look easy, but they are actually quite detailed mm-hmm. when you are on the highest level. And it's sometimes hard to see. I'm working a lot on my Instagram with something called Do's and Don'ts, where I show like the common mistakes mm-hmm. people are doing, and then I show how I'm doing it, technical advice. And then I think that's a pretty good like way to see it, that it looks like this, and for most of the players who are playing on not the highest level, it looked like this, but it actually should look more mm-hmm. like this. But I think that most of the shots, yeah, they look easy, but it's because we're professional. It's the same with cricket, I think. It looks so easy when they hit with the bat, but you know, you're standing there with the bat, it's coming so fast, the ball, and yeah, it's almost impossible to hit it the way you want it. So
Yeah, your Instagram page, when you touched upon, that's so true. So I play badminton every other day and every other week, and when I go through your do's and don'ts, it boggles my mind, because it's those little things that matter so much. Like, even if it's generating power or angling the shuttle, Now, we have a lot of questions on your mental aspect of things because I think that's very important to you. But in the recently concluded, sorry for my friend's pronunciation, but Orléans Masters 2021 last month, you had a tremendous tournament there and you came as a runner-up. But what a tournament. You won, I think, 4 straight set matches. I think that was pretty great. My question to you is, first of all, how was the experience through the tournament? Because it's been a long time and I'm sure you have had tournaments before, but with this COVID and everything. And also, as someone who gets defeated in the final, I'm sure it's mentally quite difficult, even if you had a great run up until then. So what was your experience like and how do you overcome that defeat, especially in a final?
The tournament for me in Orléans was a little bit special because I got a new sports, what do you call it, psychiatrist or psychologist?
Mm-hmm. Psychologist. Yeah,
psychologist. For like, it must be, it was in start February, so it's pretty new. And and we started to like, working together and thinking of ways I could like stay in the zone, and I have been having a lot of trouble with having too many thoughts when I was playing. So I was not in the moment when I was playing the rally. I was thinking of something else, and that made me do a lot of mistakes when I was playing, because when you're not in the moment, you are reacting. You're not taking the right decisions and stuff like that. So we had this four to 6 weeks before the tournament to like come up with some ideas to what I could do about it. And I actually think that I felt it worked at the training better and better, but it's still something else to do it in a tournament. I was actually pretty nervous when I was when I was in the first round, because I know it was a good player as well, but I also knew that I was favorite, and I'm not feeling that comfortable to being a favorite. I like to be the underdog, because I feel that of course you don't have as much to lose when you are a favorite. But then I won, and I won quite. Not easily, but I think I handled it pretty good. And then from that match and to the finals, I just felt like I used all the things that I have talked with my psychiatrist about, and it just felt great. And I also think that if I maybe had won the first set in the final, that maybe he was seeing that it's going to be a tough and a hard match, and maybe I could be a little bit on top of the mental part. But I did manage to close the gap, but I think I learned a lot for the final from the final, because I'm not used to standing in the final, so it was of course great, but I also played a good match when it was my first time in the Super 100 final. Mm-hmm. So I have taken a lot with me after finals, but to be more specific, I wanted the points in the end. I was leading 19-15 and I wanted the last 2 points, and that cost me the first set, because then I took I didn't take the risks, but I was feeling that when I get the when I got the chance, I had to take it, because I was not patient enough, and I didn't believe that I would get a better chance in that moment when I was about to hit. So I think if I could just have played a little bit more patient with maybe 1 or 2 strokes more, I could have got the last 2 points in that first set. So that is the major thing I would take with me from the final. So I will say, like Kobe Bryant, it's only failing if you're not if you are thinking you have failed.
But what a tournament! That was a brilliant tournament you had there. But like you mentioned, you also mentioned your mental coach in that particular post on your Instagram, and I found that very fascinating because not a lot of people do it. Not a lot of people thank them openly. I was wondering if so, right, when you said during rallies you think a lot. So does the pressure get to you? Is so what was the ticking point of I need to get help, I need to figure out a way of making sure I'm focusing on the shuttle while rallying? And does the pressure get to you for bigger players in front of you? Or like you said, you like to be the underdog, but does the pressure environment get to you?
I think it's after I got the new psychologist, I think it's getting better and better. I'm just focusing more on the rallies instead of these thoughts I can't control. I can't control if he's playing, if he's having a good day or mm-hmm. something like that. I just, of course, there is. I have been at not especially good having a pressure on me. I have been the kind of person who felt like I need to get off court. I don't feel comfortable in here, and it should be that one place I felt the most comfortable because that's the only thing I'm doing right now. So to feel uncomfortable in your safe zone on court, it's not a it doesn't feel good. So I also, one of my main things I had to do when I played Orléans was to have fun. So mm-hmm. that's a little bit special for mm-hmm. a professional athlete to say, but I just were in a place that I just had to have fun when I was playing instead of thinking of the results all the time. I was just a few months back, I was thinking a lot of, I need to get this point, every point. And when you do that, you put a really big amount of pressure on yourself, because then it's like you're playing settings all the time, because you want the next point, you want also the next point, instead of you can't play a whole match without making any mistakes. So I didn't give me room to do the mistakes. So I was feeling locked and couldn't move so good. And I had all these bad thoughts who just made me feel very uncomfortable. But it seems like the past weeks it has getting better and better. And I think I know the way now.
That's really nice to hear, man. I mean, it's great that you,
Sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to say that I appreciate you for being so vocal about this.
Yeah.
Because not a lot of players do, and a lot of champion players like yourself, because Praatibh and I, once when we were trying to be professional cricketers, we had the same thoughts, and we were wondering if players like yourself who represent countries do it. So before Praatibh can go on, I just wanted to thank you for being so vocal about the mental struggles that you're going through, and the fact that you're finding help for it. I think it's great.
Yeah.
And so, sorry, Praatibh, you can go on. You can.
Yeah. So now on a much lighter note, can you tell us if you have any superstitions that you maybe follow, or any sort of rituals that you sort of have before the game?
I used to have a lot, like I should tie my shoes before, and I should, I should listen to the same song, there were so many, I can't remember them all. There was a lot, but I just try to find it. I still have one, but it's not the same I do to get it, mm-hmm. because it's a feeling.
Okay.
I try to get the same feeling. Before I go in for a match, and it's a hard feeling to get, because it's a feeling where you feel like combat mode but also relaxed.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So right. It's like you have to feel like, okay, the body is ready, but the mind is relaxed, like right. and can control the body. So that's my one superstition as it is now. But it has been a lot worse.
Right.
But I think athletes on a high level use it to trigger that feeling. Mm-hmm. So right. I've just been, right. I'm just getting better to find it without having the same things to do.
And it's nice that you found a right balance, because there can be times when you haven't done the same routine and that can play on your mind during the match. Yeah. And that can be a lot of trouble. Now, you touched upon your Instagram page and I wanted to talk to you about it, because I'm not a professional badminton player, but I play the sport like any other kid in our country. But just going through your page, there's so much positivity in it. And that's what attracted me towards it. One of the reasons we wanted to talk to you is because, of course, you're an international player. But second, your page just shines out so much positivity. And you always emphasize on how hard work beats talent. And that's something I wanted to ask you about, because there are a lot of kids out there who play cricket or anything, writer or even a movie maker, who think that, who stop doing what they want to do because they think they're not talented enough. So what do you tell those kids out there who think that talent is above hard work?
Well, I think that I'm a good, example, mm-hmm. because I'm not I have practiced a lot of technical skills, and maybe more than a lot here the past years, but maybe when they were younger, they practiced that a lot more than me. So I had to catch up,
right.
because they were technical better than me when we grew up. And that maybe made me feel like, okay, I'm not that talented as they are, and it didn't look like that, but I just kept like pressure them when we were playing, and I felt like, okay, if I can just get a little bit better technical, I can beat those guys. And then I just started to practice harder and harder, and I still do it. I try to be a better version than I was yesterday. So I think that I just know what those guys are going through who don't think they are as much talented than the other kid they are comparing themselves to. I have been there. I have done it. I'm still doing it. I hope that I can show the players or the athletes who think that they are not good enough that they can come a lot of way with hard work and a lot of practice. I cannot say that it's not hard. It's hard mm-hmm. mentally. Mm-hmm. It's you have to be a training addict almost. You have to love it, because if not, you are having a lot of bad thoughts, and maybe you're not giving it 100% when you're at practice, because you're thinking like, oh, it's so unfair that the guy over there, he seems so effortless when he's yeah. playing and practicing, and he's still better than me and stuff like that. You have to think that, okay, maybe he's better than me in the game right now, but I will be better at practice than him. I will do more drills that he is doing. I will do more gym that he is doing. I will, when I'm not practicing my sport, I will be practicing something else that can help me with my sport. So I just, it was not the idea when I started my Instagram page like this. I mainly did it because I wanted to find some sponsors. And mm-hmm. And then I just found out that what people were liking when I was posting, and then I just started to post more and more, and then I find my like a theme for my page, and then it just exploded in December. I mm-hmm. had a reel with a rally who went up for I think 1.5
yeah.
million
yeah.
views, and I was just like, okay, That's crazy. I haven't seen that on another badminton page. So that was like a turning point for me that like, okay, I can maybe take it a little bit further. And then I came up with the do's and don'ts, and it just took off. And then now I'm here with I don't know 15,000 more followers, maybe 17,000 more followers. So as I started with Instagram for 1 year ago in Corona because I was bored. I didn't know what to do. I couldn't train. I couldn't practice. Mm-hmm. And then I talked with my she's my ex-girlfriend now. She was helping me with the sponsors and stuff, and I was saying like, can you help me find a sponsor? And she was mm-hmm. like, yeah, but you have to work on your Instagram because it's not good enough to get sponsors at it is right now. And then we started this Instagram project together, and we started with 500 followers. And,
now you have 21k.
Yeah, it has been a good year on Instagram.
But Praatibh, before you go on, I just want to say this again, that don't stop what you're doing because it's great. Like someone like me who doesn't even play the sport professionally, I think there's so much good that comes out of it. And I'm sure you get a lot of positive feedback too. Like it's fantastic to just go through your page. There's not only the games of yours, fantastic. Like you said, that rally of yours, which hit 1 million viewers. That's great. But even what you teach us and the way you talk about things, I think it's nice. It's good to know.
I really appreciate it. That's also why I like doing it, because I get a lot of positive feedback. I almost don't. You should be careful what you're saying, but I don't feel like I have no haters. I just feel a lot of positive feedback, and I have also a lot of Indian followers who are really really nice, but they also come out pretty strong sometimes. Like, can I call you? I will call you. Pick up the phone. I'm at practice and talk right now. Can you text me and then I will come back to you? It's just nice that they like the page so much. They are not as shy as Danish players. But I think
that's really amazing to hear.
But I think it's amazing that I'm starting to like motivate the people a little bit more, like in the effort beats talent every single day kind of thing, because I think it's a thing I will stand in for. I will be that example if I can, because I think it's important. Because I hear a lot of this talent, but if I have a talent, I would say it would be a talent for practicing, and I of course I also have some genetic things I'm high, I'm pretty strong, I'm careful again. I don't get injured. I have never been injured more than 2 weeks. And that's not very normal for a guy who practices more than the most people do. But I just think it's a part of my genes. And that's also something I really appreciate. Thank you, mom and dad. I just think you should be careful to say that talent is everything, because it's not. So that's what I'm trying to like get people to understand, that if you are put in the hard work, you can accomplish a lot more than you think.
Yeah, I think that's a brilliant message that you've put out, and I think it is pretty evident, as you said, with your example itself. And we really hope that you sort of do a lot better and you come out and win championships. Now, the last question from my side is on sort of your future plans and goals. What targets have you set, or do you set targets as such?
Yes, I do. I have never been like that much into setting goals and stuff like that. I have always had a goal that I will be the best. I will try to be the best version of me. So I didn't want to set a limit. Like, if I could be the best in the world, I would still try to improve as much as I could, because you can always improve. So I tried to have a goal when I was younger to not have a limit on my goal, and I still like to say that I will try to be the best I can when I talk about my goals. But I actually have a quite specific goal, that's I want to be in the top 50 in the in summer 2022. So from a little bit over a year from now, I like to be in the top 50. I have moved a lot on the last two tournaments in Saint-Lux and Orléans. I moved from 120 something to 83.
83, so,
yeah. So, and I also I have won against a lot of the players who are in top 50. So I know I have the level, but it's just as you say, to control the pressure and have the courage to do the right things when you are in the moment. Don't go after the easy points as I did in the final, but stay in the moment and take the right chances. Then I think I can reach my goal. But I would like to play that because I have that goal. It's also because I want to play in the biggest tournaments like All England and World Championships and stuff like that. So I want to be on the big scene in the future. So
I'm sure it's about time you reach top 50, and I know both of us will be wishing you luck. I cannot thank you enough for giving your time, because I think it's been a learning curve in a lot of ways. The fact that you spoke about mental health and even physical, and even your thoughts, how especially how hard work beats talent, that's something I'll hold on to. Mads, I cannot thank you enough for joining in. Thank you so much for coming in, guys. If we spoke a lot about our Instagram page, his Instagram page, not ours, but his Instagram page. So we'll link that down below, and please check him out, because even if you're not into badminton, and even if you don't want to play, I think you get a lot more than just badminton from his page. And I think it'll be great if you check it out. We'll put it in the description below. Mads, again, thank you so much for joining in.
Yeah, thank you for having me, guys. It's been a pleasure.
Yo, thanks for tuning into the latest episode of Just Baatein. We hope you enjoyed it and that it left you inspired. Thanks for all your support, and maybe you could support us just a little more by maybe going to our Instagram and Twitter and giving us a follow there. And also you can listen to us on all podcasting platforms, right from Spotify to Apple Podcasts to Google Podcasts. Cheers.